Well, hello there. My name is Jon Weil here at Fuzzywallz Mastering, and today I'd like to take a little time and explain the waveform statistics window with an iZotope RX. Let's get right into it. In order to pull up the window that we're speaking of, you could go up here to the iZotope menu and click on Waveform Statistics. That's one way to do it. That's kind of a time-consuming way to do it. The way I like to do it is on Mac, Option D. And if you've got a PC, that would be Alt-D, brings you up the same window. So now we see the statistics window here, and I've got it overlaid upon a commercially available pop song that you've probably heard, and it seems to be a good example. The first number I'd like to look at here is sample peak level. iZotope explains this as the maximum level of digital samples in your selection. So this is just plain as day, how loud does the loudest digital peak in the whole file get? And in this case, it goes almost up to full-scale digital, negative 0.01 decibels. What this tells me is that this was mastered with some sort of digital limiter that essentially rounded off or cut off the peak right before it got all the way up to zero to prevent clipping. And this is helpful to know. In fact, a lot of DAWs metering, their digital meters will be showing the sample peak level. However, true peak level is a little different. iZotope says this is the highest peak level detected, including signal levels between digital samples. They also say that this reflects the expected peak levels of the analog waveform after digital to analog conversion, and they say that it's calculated by oversampling and that different software may measure this differently. So this can be a little confusing. What's going on here is you can have a sample peak level that's below zero, but still have a true peak level, like here, that's above zero. So what's going on? To illustrate this, I'm going to click on the yellow flag where it can show you where this is happening. If you zoom in, I found it. So what's kind of weird is that the sample peak level never goes past zero as far as when they measure the actual samples. But you can see when they're showing how the waveform is going to be reconstructed, for example, when it comes out of your DAW or out of RX and goes through a digital analog converter and tries to go out your speaker, what's happening or what might happen is you might get a bit of a clip. And this could be fine. It could sound like just fine, or it could cause distortion. Where I've found that this is really important and can cause the most issues is if you were to take this file and convert it to MP3 or some sort of other compressed audio format, then you might start actually hearing distortion in these spots, and it's something to be aware of and something to audition. So that's true peak level, is how loud is it really going to come out of your speakers as opposed to what is the level within your computer. Now, total RMS level, this is an average measurement of the power of your track. So this isn't so much of a digital measurement as more of like an old school analog measurement. In fact, RMS has been used in meters since the beginning of audio reproduction would be the right word. If you look at a console or an analog piece of gear, you'll see meters that you know have needles and they move a little slower. These are typically RMS meters. And in this case, RX is saying that the total RMS level is negative 7.49 and negative 7.62. Those are the two different channels. And that's just an average measurement. Now, RMS does not care about frequencies. It's just looking at an average level. And RX says that it's measured using 50 millisecond windows. So 50 milliseconds is pretty short. But just think average volume, not peak, not digital peak. This is more of a average listening level. The max and minimum RMS levels here, those are indicating the highest and lowest RMS points of the track. So
rather than the peak highest or peak lowest, this is looking at the average and showing you where it's the highest for the maximum RMS and lowest for the minimum RMS. Now, possibly clipped samples here, this is kind of referring back to the true peak level. Or if you have sample peaks that are really close to zero, you may find that there's possibly clipped samples. And like I did before, you can click on one of the flags, either one, and zoom in. In this case, I'm looking at the right channel. Let's see what's going on there. Boom, you can see it right there. It is claiming there's 49,279 possibly clipped samples there. That sounds like a lot, but when you zoom in, you can see that this is just the tiniest moment of time. So this may sound fine, it may not, and that's why it's helpful to be able to find this and listen to it, and maybe even listen to it again after you've converted it to any other sort of file format. That's possibly clipped samples. Super cool feature. Moving on. DC offset. Now, this is a measurement of DC offset. Oh, so what is that? The way I think about this is when you look at a digital waveform in your DAW, you'll see that normally it's kind of hanging around a center line and it goes up and down from there. Sometimes if something was recorded or mixed with poorly calibrated or even broken equipment, sometimes if there's huge amounts of low frequency, you'll see the waveform hanging off to one side, which isn't the end of the world, but that can also limit your headroom, and that can cause all sorts of weirdness later if you're not aware of it. Now, in this track, the DC offset is at negative 0.007%. That's super low. That's negligible. This is normal. In fact, I wouldn't really even worry about this number unless you're starting to creep up into, like, I don't know, 2%, 5%. At that point, you're probably losing some headroom, and it's an indicator that there might be some other issues going on. A quick way to fix it would be to run a high-pass filter, let's just say at like 20 hertz or something. Here in RX, you can also use this phase module to fix that if you need to, and we can make a video on that later if you'd like. Moving down to max momentary loudness. So this is a measurement. It looks like iZotope says that they're measuring this over the course of 400 milliseconds. So this is the loudest 400 milliseconds of your track. Now, 400 milliseconds isn't even half a second, so this is a short time period. So this is just saying, like, momentarily, what's the loudest moment? And in this reading, along with all the ones below it, they're factoring frequencies different. So essentially, our ears are more sensitive to mid-range frequencies. Super low frequencies and super high frequencies are not being counted equally when we're looking at any of these LUFS or LU readings. So once again, max momentary loudness is the loudest 400 milliseconds of the track, accounting more for the frequencies that we're more sensitive to. Kind of useful. This can kind of indicate what the loudest snare hit is or what the loudest part of a drum fill is for a track, but I wouldn't really use this to judge a loudness of a track. However, the next one, this max short-term loudness, I find this really useful for judging how loud a track gets in the way that we hear it. RX measures this, and in fact, I'm pretty sure all short-term loudness measurements within this LUFS scale are measured over the course of 3 seconds. So max short-term loudness is what is the loudest 3 seconds of your track while counting the stuff that sounds louder to our ears more than the stuff that we don't hear. Very useful. This would indicate the loudest part of your track that most people in the world will hear as being loud. So much different than a sample peak level. Sample peak levels are really nice to know and you want to keep them below zero, but you don't really hear peaks. It's just too fast. This short-term loudness reading is really helpful when you want to know how loud does it sound to a human being. Moving down to this integrated loudness, this is the one that so many people talk about these days, and a lot of the streaming services will normalize or adjust tracks to where they're at a similar or the same level. This is kind of like RMS in the fact that it's looking at an average level throughout the whole song. It's not a loudest point or a quietest point. They're saying, on average, how loud is this track while factoring in the frequencies we hear better rather than all the sub bass and high treble stuff. I really like to use integrated loudness along with short-term loudness to get a feel for how loud a track sounds. Sometimes I actually find short-term loudness to be more effective when trying to level out tracks, but unfortunately most of the rest of the world uses this integrated number to level things out. Your mileage may vary. We'll see. Finally, loudness range, this LRA. This is simply a measurement of how dynamic or not dynamic your track is. A higher number indicates more of a dynamic range. For example, if you have like a soundtrack or classical music piece, this will probably have a higher loudness range because you're going to have these big peaks and low valleys. Versus, say, something like a heavy metal track where it starts off 11 out of 10 and ends at 11 out of 10, you're going to see a pretty low loudness range here, reflected at something like even 1. But yeah, it's just an indicator of how dynamic or not dynamic your track is. And using these last three numbers, you can really, even before hearing a track, get a feel for how loud it is, how dynamic it is. Hopefully that answered some of your questions, and I'll see you next time.
If you enjoyed this video, go ahead and give it a like, and please remember to subscribe to the Fuzzywallz channel. Anything you'd like to add, feel free to leave a comment. And when that final mix is ready for mastering, Fuzzywallz is standing by.